this holy town, an auspicious day is about to dawn. These people are followers of India's biggest spiritual guru. For them, he's an avatar, God in human form. Like them, I've come today because he's promised to perform a rare miracle. As the sun finally rises, thousands are flooding in. Some have even waited all night. As he approaches, a wave of excitement ripples through the hall. The atmosphere turns feverish. These people are about to look upon the face of their living God. Sri Satya Sai Baba. There's no shortage of God in the American Midwest, but even here, Sai Baba has made inroads. During the 90s, this isolated corner of North Arkansas was the model Sai Baba commune. It was run by Al and Marissa Ram and their family.
This is incredible, Al.
So this is where we live. And also, we kept it as a, you know, we planned it as a center for the community.
And this is the house you're saying that you all built?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we built this, our family built this. And,
mm-hmm. Friends.
And a lot of friends who would come out.
We became the Arkansas Sai Baba Center.
You cut down the trees.
Meaning that it was a spiritual community based on the teachings of Sai Baba. And with guidelines that had to do with vegetarianism and...
We did study groups. We studied Sai Baba's teachings.
It was a family home.
But since it was the largest home in the community, we had our devotional singing here
like
every Thursday.
Like for Shivaratri, you know, at Shivaratri, people
parties.
Would sing all night. Mm-hmm. We would have everybody...
Each family had their own home, and the community chose to build our own schoolhouse and hired school teachers to come and live in an apartment above the schoolhouse.
How were you brought up to see Sai Baba when you were a child?
As God. Pretty straightforward. God in human form, the avatar. And I didn't really understand too much of it. But that was probably one of the main things that kind of made me feel a little excluded from most of the quote-unquote normal kids going to school and going to church, is that the fact that my family and a bunch of other families who we are associated with believe that there was a God in human form on earth now.
We believe that Sri Satya Sai Baba is Jesus Christ. Sri Satya Sai Baba is Buddha. Sri Satya Sai Baba is the founder of all of the world's religions. Sri Satya Sai Baba has always been God.
Satya Sai Baba says, whenever you see a sick person, a dispirited, disconsolate, diseased person, there is your field of service.
Today, Dr. Michael Goldstein is the guest of honor at this British Sai Baba function. He's the international chairman of the organization and a man close to Sai Baba personally.
I submit to you that every man and woman, all of us, are spiritual seekers.
I've had no sense of purpose in my life until I went to see Satya Sai Baba. In 1975, my wife and I went. We had the good fortune to interact with Satya Sai Baba. I looked into his eyes and I lost all sense of individuality and became immersed in what I felt was an ocean of love.
The Ram family also became close to Sai Baba.
So, what's down here, Al?
Well, this is a shed where we keep, you know, various tools and supplies and We have a box in there that contains all the stuff that Baba gave us that was supposedly materialized, including robes. Check it out. That's what any devotee would want.
Yeah.
This is at the height of your closeness to Sai Baba.
So these are two of the three robes that Baba gave us. Baba gave one to me, he gave one to Marisa, and he gave one to Elia.
A robe like the one he
wears. He wears.
The actual
wore.
Ones that he's already worn. Yeah. Actual size, actual everything.
I've always been fascinated by the holy men of India, the swamis, yogis, and gurus. They're part of an ancient tradition here. And then there's the godmen, human beings who declare themselves divine. With an estimated 30 million devotees spread across the world, Sai Baba is India's biggest godman, and its most controversial. For years, he's been surrounded by scandal, yet his popularity shows no sign of falling. So I've come to this Sai Baba wonderland, put a party, to explore the enigma behind the public face.
There's not the slightest doubt that he is the most popular of all the godmen and godwomen we have today. And you can't ascribe it to a kind of publicity campaign, because there's never been anything of the kind. You don't see any advertisements in magazines or on TV or anything. It was like Gandhi. No, he never had any, and yet he had this suddenly, by word of mouth, it was all over the country as the great Mahatma.
Sai Baba's followers now come from over 165 countries. Western devotees have always flocked to him.
It's a matter of great prestige to have a foreign following. Indians get highly impressed when they see white people coming and touching and becoming devotees. That applies to the Germans, Australians, Italians, Spaniards, Americans, all shaved heads with their pigtails behind them and wearing saffron. Mumbo-jumbo of the prayers that they carry out, dancing in the streets.
I met Sai Baba psychically 21 years before I met him physically.
Psychically?
Yeah.
He's in you, me, and everybody. It's like a golden light. His laugh incarnate.
Just seeing him, man, these vibrations of, spasms of ecstasy, it was like going through my body, and I was like shivering, and hair was standing on its end.
It's quite baffling.
Many devotees came from that mecca of counterculture, California. It was the late 60s, and the spirit of the age was revolution. The hippie generation sparked up, dropped out, and partied. It was also in California that Al and Marisa first met.
I was living the high life. I was in Hollywood meeting some of the top stars and thought it was all quite exciting, but at the same time, I was also pretty unaware and pretty drugged most of the time. I was just partying. Life was about beauty, being young, being famous in Hollywood, and becoming a star and being noticed.
As love and peace became the slogan of the times, many embarked on a journey of spiritual exploration.
I was on the opposite end of the spectrum. I was motivated by spiritual pursuits. I considered myself a yogi. I mean, I was doing yoga, meditation, fasting, and spiritual experiences.
Drawn by gurus like Maharishi, thousands of Westerners flocked to India seeking spiritual enlightenment. Visits from stars like the Beatles brought added glamour to the road east.
India is so unique, it's so incredible. If there's a spiritual train then India is the engine. All this mysticism, all the strangeness that surrounds Sai Baba and all that stuff, this is a perfect home for it.
This man was part of the hippie generation. But Isaac Tigret also saw the age as a wonderful business opportunity.
And of course here is a wonderful vet.
He's one of the founders of the world-famous Hard Rock Cafe. He mixed burgers and beer with rock memorabilia to create a global phenomenon and a massive personal fortune.
That was 70 pounds ago. Yes, underneath the hair is my good self here. You see, my religious life is already beginning.
The Hard Rock's so known for its memorabilia around the world, but not many people know about its association with Sai Baba.
No, it's not public knowledge, but now that I've done this interview with you guys, it certainly will be.
Isaac took Sai Baba's motto, love all, serve all, and made it the motto of the Hard Rock. But even with all his wealth and fame, Isaac felt there was still something missing from his life.
I said, look, I need to start a search. I need to go look for what I think is a master, a guru, a spiritual leader, a teacher, something, because of the hunger inside of me. But I searched all over India. I went to every ashram, every holy place. I heard about this obscure little guru, decided to go down there, and there was a festival day, there was a huge crowd, and he parted the crowd and came right over to me. I was sitting at the back, and he said, you've come at last, I've been waiting for you. So he turned and said, we have many things that we're going to do together, you wait right here. He didn't speak to me again for 15 years.
In 1979, the Ram family made their own pilgrimage to India. They were married now, and their son, Alaya, was just a baby. Marissa had embraced her husband's faith with enthusiasm. For years, she'd been having visions of Sai Baba.
I felt I was coming to heaven on earth. This was going to be the place where my Lord or God at that time lived.
A living God.
A living God. And this was his home, and I was coming to his home.
In India, the Rams imbibed the legends and history of their guru. Stories of how, as a baby, a deadly cobra was found under his blankets, but he was unharmed. How at 14, the devout young boy declared himself to be Sai Baba, God on earth. By 1950, he'd opened an ashram, a spiritual community. It was called Prashanti Nilayam, or Abode of Eternal Peace. Amidst the beauty and spirituality of India lies the reality of hard lives. Here in the vast rural state of Andhra Pradesh, villagers face drought and poverty on a daily basis. Little surprise then that when the authorities fail to deliver that essential resource, water, Sai Baba's ability to cut through the red tape means that he's hailed as a god. In the mid-1990s, his charity spent over £40 million supplying water to villages like this.
This is the Sri Satya Sai water.
Yeah, Satya Sai water.
How long has it been here?
14 years.
14 years?
14 years.
Is this good water?
It is good water. And healthy water.
This is healthy water. It's clean water.
Clean water, healthy water.
And what do you think of Sai Baba?
Sai Baba is a god.
Sai Baba is God.
The water project that he did in Andhra Pradesh, 1 year they laid 2,000 kilometers of pipe. They brought to thousands of villages fresh water that they never had, that women had to travel 20 miles a day to get a little bucket. That was an amazing project.
Isaac Tigrep did some good works of his own. By the time Sai Baba spoke to him again, he'd become an extremely rich man. When the guru told him of his dream for an ultra-modern hospital in the heart of Andhra Pradesh, Tigrep donated tens of millions of dollars. Prince Charles's architect, Keith Critchlow, who's also a Sai Baba devotee, was hired to design it. It was opened in 1991 and specialized in high-tech heart and kidney surgery, free of charge. Tigrep is convinced that the hospital, built on blood, sweat and burgers, was worthy of his generosity. And certainly his guru was grateful.
This vessel, silver vessel, is a flower of love.
Can you tell me how much you donated to the hospital?
Well, I don't really want to say the exact amount, but I'll tell you, in India, it goes a long way. A long, long way.
I've heard it was over $100 million.
No, nothing close to that. Enough to build a 500-room hospital and equip it and get it started.
The Ram family went back to India in 1997. By then, Alaya was a handsome teenager. At the ashram, they eagerly attended Darshan, the daily mass audience with their god.
The first day, Baba came walking out, and he saw Alaya, and his eyes got real big, and then he looked at me, and he said, "How many in your group?" And we said, 10. He said, "You go in, you call us in for an interview."
Sai Baba was about to fulfill one of Alaya's lifelong dreams. He materialized a sacred ring for him.
I was overjoyed. And I had heard my mom often talk about, "Ooh, I would love to get a ring from Sai Baba. I would love to get a ring from Sai Baba." So I thought it was just the best thing in the world that had happened to me. The fact that he had given me a ring, I was overjoyed.
Underpinning Sai Baba's claim to be a living god is an apparent ability to perform miracles. Many of his followers, and even some of his critics, believe that he has genuine paranormal powers. Over the years, the godman has produced scores of objects out of thin air. Watches, rings, necklaces.
These are things such as Sai Baba has made. This watch, these rings, and this. Sometimes he will give somebody something and produce, manifest something, and it's like a calling card. It gets their attention so that they can come and see what he really has to offer.
But for many devotees like young Alaya Ram, Sai Baba's generosity came at a cost.
At the same time I was overjoyed, it was also a little bit of confusion, because that was the first interview in which he called me in personally.
He took you aside?
Mm-hmm. Took me aside and put the oil on his hands and told me to drop my pants and rub my genitalia with the oil and pulled me close and started kissing me heavily on the mouth. And I was really taken back by it and not understanding what was going on.
I said, "So tell me about, you know, your interview." And he said, "Well, I'm not supposed to tell anybody. Baba told me not to tell anybody." And I looked at him and I said, "Did he make oil for you?" And his eyes got kind of big and he said, "How did you know?" And I said, "Did he rub it on you?" And he said, "Yeah." He said, "How did you know?" And I said, "Because it happened to me."
To Elias' surprise, his father had had the same oiling experience when he first visited Sai Baba aged 18. The guru had told him it was a ritual healing process. Al accepted this, and when it happened to Alaya, he saw nothing wrong. There are still some who are not afraid to pour scorn on Sai Baba's claims of divinity. Basava Premanand is India's leading guru buster and a rationalist. His mission is to expose any charlatan who pretends his magic tricks are miracles, and to rid his country of superstition and myth.
How many years have you been chasing Sai Baba then?
So I've been investigating him since 1968, investigating and drawing my conclusions and keeping it as a hobby.
What do you think of
it? The
now?
Thing is, we can explain miracles.
Yes.
We can expose people who act like miracle men. And it was in 1976 I started going to the public.
Today, we've hit the road with the rationalists to see them at work, persuading people to give up blind belief and become more scientific. We've come to the village of Belthangary. The people here are typical of the bulk of Sai Baba's followers. For the rationalists, this is the front line in the battle between superstition and science. Today, another leading rationalist is the ringmaster, revealing the tricks that lie behind Sai Baba's miracles, Narendra Nayak.
A few years back, a miracle was performed by Sai Baba in public. He showed his empty hands, waved it in the air, and he produced a chain. Both hands were empty, five fingers were apart. Just hold his empty hand like this, and you're all busy looking at it. Just invert it like this. And here I produce a chain from thin air.
Narendra also reveals that the same technique is behind one of the Guru's most famous displays, the materialization of Vibhuti, a holy ash sacred to Hindus. It's the basic magician's trick of palming.
Great Sai Baba Puttaparthi gives ash to his devotees. He just takes his empty hand, waves it in the air like this, and when he brings it down, he produces holy ash from nowhere. Usually, godmen give with one hand, but I'm giving with both the hands. Good. How does it happen? Very, very easy.
So, Narendra, how do you hide the vibhuti in your hand?
I just hide it in between my thumb and my index finger like this.
That's right?
Yes, just like that. But you must be absolutely relaxed, so that nobody will know what's happening. Yeah. And when you wave it in the air like this, you just crush it like this and you distribute the vibhuti to the people.
It's quite difficult to do, actually, isn't it?
But we have practiced it quite a lot.
Okay.
Every miracle man rotates their hand before they produce something. Do you know why? People don't see the movement of the fingers because the hand is rotating.
Back at the ashram, and the Shivaratri festival was in full swing. But the strain of the promised miracle seemed to be taking its toll. The god was looking unwell. He'd pledged to give birth through his mouth to an egg-shaped object called a golden lingam. It's said to represent the mystery of the cosmos. There's little mystery to Sai Baba's own teachings. He urges people to believe in God, to be charitable, truthful, and peace-loving. It's not radical thinking, but perhaps that's the secret of its appeal. Mark Roach devoted 25 years of his life to Sai Baba. He first heard of him in 1969. And soon joined the local center in California. The guru's message was the big attraction.
The teachings themselves were very universal and adopted the attitude of embracing all other religions, so that it wasn't a matter of this religion opposed to that, that you had to leave whatever you were in to be associated with Sai Baba. It was something that just be a better Christian or a better Jew or a better whatever it is, rather than necessarily having to leave it. Mixed with the fact that the person who is the head of that is claiming to be God himself.
It's a special moment when God calls. and Mark couldn't believe his luck when he was summoned for a private interview. But he emerged shocked and confused. Just like the Ram, Sai Baba had oiled his genitals. 2 years later, Mark was called for an audience again.
He kept saying stuff like that. I'm giving you a great chance. Millions want to touch their feet. You know, I'm giving you whole bodies. This is a great chance. This is a great chance. Then he went over to a different part of the room and pulled up his dhoti, which is an Indian garment kind of thing, and exposed himself and sort of indicated that I was supposed to put his penis in my mouth, which, feeling intimidated and confused and all that, I did. And although it didn't seem right to me, but it just seemed like what I was supposed to do.
Why would God want to put his penis in your mouth?
Got me.
One of the things that a lot of the abuse victims we've talked to have said is that Sai Baba does these genital oilings because it's part of Hinduism. Have you ever heard anything?
For one, it's nothing to do with, there's no Indian tradition to support the fact that, you know, worship of the linga includes also doing the blowjob, if that is what you are referring to. I don't think there's any basis for that whatsoever.
Stand by the stairway, you'll see something certain to tell you. Confusion has its cause.
Back in America, the Ram family were fast becoming the stars of the Sai Baba community. They traveled across the country, preaching the gospel according to Baba.
This is a song that was an extreme joy to be able to sit there right in front of him and look into his eyes when we sang the song. It's called O Baba.
Sai Baba.
Marissa and Alaya formed a singing group called Bhakti, which means Path of Love. Stars of the spiritual circuit, they were the perfect New Age family, the embodiment of the love all, serve all dream.
And we talk and tell stories in between, what, you know, what inspired this song, and, you know, Al would, you know, tell a story about Sai Baba, and really it was kind of a hit.
The family were proving to be quite a hit too. On their various visits to put a party, the Rams were being singled out for unprecedented attention from their guru.
This is a lot of the jewelry. These are all pure gold watches.
Yeah, pure gold with real diamonds. He said,
real gold, 100%, real diamonds. The next day, diamonds fall out, the gold starts flaking, and people are like, what's the deal with that? You must not be pure.
Baba was giving him money. I think he gave him several thousand dollars. He gave him a watch and a ring. He gave all
of us. A couple of rings.
We all got rings and watches and
earrings.
Yeah,
it was just like the trip to Disneyland with God. I mean, we were just really ecstatic with joy getting this attention in this limelight.
What Al and Marissa didn't know was that while he was showering their family with gifts and attention, Sai Baba was exacting a heavy price from their son.
Oral sex, he would try to get that to happen several times. Both on, he would perform it to me, and then, you know, and then sometimes threaten to cut my penis off and hold it and be like, it's bad, I should cut it off. He would ask me all the time, why don't you want me? You don't want me? It was so far out to me to think that he was actually just wanting me to physically want him. I could pretty much stop convincing myself that any of this was spiritual. When he lifted his robe and his dhoti up to his chest and showed me the whole bottom half of his body, and told me to take my pants off, and then he tried to, I'm much taller than he is, he's like 5 feet tall maybe, and I'm 6'6", and he tried to climb up onto me, you know,
to rape you.
Yeah, that's what it felt like. I mean, he was
for a 70-year-old man, as erect as I think a 70-year-old man could get. I even saw semen come out of his penis one time. And that was when I was, wow, this is a human being.
In spite of the growing abuse, Alaya continued to play the dutiful son.
No, I think Swami's plan for me is, he said, we're all tools, and we just have to be available for Swami to use us at any time that he feels necessary. And so I just want to be ready, because I imagine that he's going to snatch me up and say, I need to use a screwdriver right about now and just use me, so I need to be there. And I'm doing what I can. I've even heard my mom say so many times, you know, oh, now is the golden time. We're getting attention. You know, Alaya, whatever Sai Baba is telling you to do, do it. Whatever you're doing it right, because God is paying attention to us.
And yet she had no idea how tragic her words actually were.
Right.
Sai Baba the god was beginning to appear all too human. Rumors of sexual abuse have been circulating for years, but rarely have they been made as explicit as in Alaya's story. It's said there are also many young Indian victims, but they're too afraid to speak out openly. Defying the organization here could have serious consequences. Absolute faith is demanded. At these celebrations of the Hindu god Lord Shiva, the people seem to have willingly surrendered themselves in mind and in spirit. Their faith was about to be rewarded. Suddenly, there it was, a golden lingam, a symbol of the Supreme Being. And to the devotees around me, it was a miracle.
Ego.
On the rationalist roadshow, Mr. Premanand was also feeling unwell.
It's paining, stomach is paining. He used to have it inside. That's a regurgitation trick which is practiced by many magicians.
So yes. Some people will actually swallow it and regurgitate it.
The regurgitation. But he stopped doing it.
How do you know he stopped doing it?
Because now we see the towel in the hand. And the
so when he's
palming,
moving the towel
yes,
to his
yeah,
mouth.
He puts it. Sometimes he takes a sip of water from a glass and then he slips it into his mouth.
And he's vomiting
yeah.
up at
yeah,
all
he's vomiting
the time.
Out. Sometimes he vomits it out like that. Sometimes he hides it in a towel and he will do the actions and say, then drop it from that.
But the exertion of miracle making had proved too much, even for a god. To the alarm of the crowd, suddenly Sai Baba collapsed. His huge coterie of staff swung into action. There was panic. An organization used to tight control seemed to have lost its grip. Sai Baba was hastily wheeled off stage. For the Ram family, the tragedy was coming to a head. Alaya's parents were noticing changes in their son.
You think so?
He wasn't looking happy, even in India, going into these interviews. I would wait until he would come out, and he didn't look happy to go in, and he didn't really look happy to come out. And there was a suspicion growing in me that, you know, things were going wrong.
Don't put the eight ball in there right there. You know what I'm saying?
Oh!
Man, you out.
We were concerned about Elias' behavior and the way he was acting, and so we decided we were going to confront him. Well, to my surprise, when Elias said okay and he started to tell the story, it was so much more than I knew anything about. And that, in fact, he had been forced, sexually forced and abused by Sai Baba in almost every single interview he had ever been in.
What did you feel like as his mother and father listening to that?
It's like everything went white for me. I just, the being which I call Sai Baba, the living God that I had taken for years into my private heart, had been truly abusing my son for so long. I felt completely betrayed that I had actually led my son into this, telling my son to trust in this man completely. And Sai Baba, the Sai Baba, was a predator and a man who cared only for himself and for taking precious love from his devotees. And really, I can see now, he really didn't care about me. He wanted my son.
First thing I said was, Elia, you only told me this one little thing. Why didn't you tell us all of this before? Why have you waited so long?
Why didn't you tell your parents?
Well, because he would tell me not to tell them. He would threaten me. I mean, I remember him saying, if you don't do what I say, your life will be full with pain and suffering. And that's a pretty heavy thing to hear, being 16, and God's telling you, do what I say, or your life is going to be filled with pain and suffering.
And he said, and I was afraid, he said, I was so afraid that I would be responsible for bringing down the organization
and possibly
and
losing us.
That I would lose my parents. He said, I was afraid that you guys might choose to follow Sai Baba and I would be without my family and no one in the world to, I would be alone.
What do you think now, looking at all these things that were so cherished by you?
Really, one word comes to my mind when I look at this box, and I would say that this is a box of bribes.
Yeah.
Sri S.A. Kalwani of Indonesia.
At 78, Sai Baba is becoming frail. His reputation is also showing signs of strain. But his support from India's power elite is as strong as ever. Prime ministers and presidents, judges and generals, all go to worship at the ashram.
His Excellency, the President of India.
Even the newly elected leader has paid his respects.
The Honourable Mr. Manmohan Singh.
The people at the top are aware of the rumours as they've been around for at least 30 years. 3 years ago, in response to claims against Sai Baba, the former Prime Minister Atal Vajpayee issued a letter on his official notepaper, calling the allegations wild, reckless and concocted. Did the government of India know something? Had they investigated Sai Baba and found him to be as pure as he proclaimed? I went to Delhi, the political heart of India, to find out why successive governments have given him such support.
Do you agree with the contents of Mr. Vajpayee's letter?
I do agree that these charges appear to be baseless.
Are you aware of the nature of the claims against Sai Baba?
Well, what I have read something. Mm-hmm. And I know Sai Baba very well. I know most of these people very well. And I can say that whatever Mr. Vajpayee has said is the correct position.
The correct position for Mr. Joshi and other former government ministers appears to have been side by side with Sai Baba. Until the recent election, he was a senior minister in the Indian government, a powerful man. Five a.m. and these devotees have been awake. We were interested to know if any future investigation of Sai Baba had been compromised by the former Prime Minister's letter.
Isn't the point, really, that any possible investigation by the state of Sai Baba would be compromised?
No, there is no question. Any false allegation, you see. I know that this is a case in which your BBC is involved and people from England have been making certain charges against Sai Baba, but that doesn't make that the charges are true.
I just wanted to know whether you think that there's a danger that the Indian government could be bringing itself into disrepute by so many leading members of this government being associated.
No. Not so.
Mr. Joshi would brook no criticism. He was starting to lose his temper.
It is your intention to malign Sai Baba. It is your intention to malign Mr. Vajpayee and Mr. Bhagwati.
Not at all.
This is, and nothing beyond it.
No, it's not.
It is.
I know.
You know the meaning of interviewing a minister in my capacity, as a minister of my stature?
Of course I understand.
You don't understand it.
Not every government, I discovered, is so enamored with Sai Baba. The scale of the abuse has caused alarm around the world. In Sweden, a Sai Baba school closed down after disturbing revelations from a young boy. The American government is also concerned. On the website of the American Embassy in Delhi, there's a warning to any US citizen visiting the state of Andhra Pradesh. It draws attention to a noted godman who reportedly indulges in inappropriate sexual behavior with young male devotees. We contacted the US Embassy in Delhi and they confirmed to us for the first time that they're directly referring to Sai Baba. Sex abuse is not the only controversy tainting the godman's reputation. On a June night back in 1993, four devotees broke into Sai Baba's quarters. They were armed with knives. Their motives are unclear. All four were close to Sai Baba. Some say they wanted to warn him about corruption in the ashram. Others claim their intention was to kidnap or even kill Sai Baba. As they approached, they were stopped by four of Sai Baba's attendants. In the struggle that followed, two of his attendants were killed and the other two badly injured. Hearing the commotion, Sai Baba escaped through a back stairway and raised the alarm. Heavily armed police arrived on the scene.
So these boys, they ran and locked themselves up in a room. And then the whole, all around, a lot of pandemonium and people gathered. So the boys were shivering like rats in that small hole.
The four men barricaded themselves into Sai Baba's bedroom. There was a standoff with the police. Then the order was given to go in. What happened next is hotly disputed. The official version seemed clear.
These four boys charged towards the police with the knives and started stabbing the inspector and the other personnel. Because they were attacked, they opened fire.
In self-defense?
In self-defense. They opened fire and killed all the four boys. This is the police story.
Thank you. Vilayudhan Nair rejects the police version of events. He should know. Until 2002, he was Home Secretary of Andhra Pradesh and in charge of the state police. On coming to office, he examined the files and found that the original police report was riddled with lies and inconsistencies. This was later exposed by a CID investigation.
Two or three daggers cannot be a match to roaring guns. So the story of police being attacked and the police shooting in self-defense is totally baseless.
So are you suggesting that the police executed the boys that night?
This is absolute cold-blooded murder.
Some police officers were arrested, but never charged. The case was eventually dropped. Sai Baba has always had a close relationship with the police. Even today, senior officers are special guests at the ashram. With friends in such high places, Sai Baba seems to be untouchable. Any attempt to investigate the goings-on at his ashram, even murder, appeared doomed to failure.
Don't tell him.
What are you going to say to him?
Critics say police connections ensured that Sai Baba wasn't even interviewed, despite being one of the witnesses to the events of that night.
The only person who was a witness to the murders or mysterious deaths was Sai Baba. And he was not examined as for evidence at all. And those students also who were there, two, three students, they were not examined at all.
Why do you think that the 1993 murders weren't properly investigated?
The central government stopped the investigation because if the investigation takes place, a lot of things will come out. One thing, economic offenses, sex offenses, all these things will come up.
Shocked at what he considers a travesty of justice, the former Home Secretary is now seeking to reopen the case.
The killing of the boys was only to buy silence. If the boys are taken to the court of law, if they were arrested and taken to the court of law, they would have stated several things, including why did they want to meet Baba.
In Arkansas, the parents of Alaya Ram were also seeking justice. They were confident they were going to get it.
Al and I are driving in the car going, oh my God, we thought we had information that was going to bring down a giant organization.
The Rams took their son's story to Dr. Michael Goldstein. He's the international chairman in charge of running the organization around the world. He's also a medical doctor, so Al had no qualms about telling him the whole painful story. It was September 1999.
Initially, he appeared shocked.
And very shaken.
And shaken. And he said, I hate to think that 25 years of my life has been for nothing. And he said, faith has got to be restored and words will not be enough.
And those were his words to me. He looked me straight in the eye and said that. And that gave me hope.
Michael said, I'm going to personally talk to Sai Baba about this. I'm going to talk to Sai Baba. And please don't tell anyone until I have a chance to get back with you.
Dr. Goldstein did go to India to question Sai Baba. When we originally interviewed him, he refused to discuss any of the negative allegations about his guru. We asked again on several occasions. He declined. But we felt these issues deserved an answer. We decided to secretly film Dr. Goldstein at his home in California to discover just how he'd gone about investigating Elias' case.
In terms of allegations, Sai Baba's actual words were, if you want to fight with people in the gutter, you also have to go into the gutter. Don't.
Dr. Goldstein's idea of an investigation was rather different to what the Rams had had in mind.
He comes back, he calls me, and he says, well, I talked to Sai Baba. I did what I said I would do. Swami said that he is pure. Michael said, my heart and my mind are with Swami. You have to do whatever you have to do.
I yes, I said that. Yes.
But was that enough of an investigation, Dr. Goldstein?
Yes, it is. For me, it is enough.
Wait a minute. What happened to words will not be enough? Faith has to be restored. 25 years of your life.
You sound to me that you're completely unafraid of these allegations because you don't believe them for one second.
That's right.
Then why don't you
allow
some transparency into the investigation of them?
Transparency in what sense?
Why don't you have thorough investigations instead of just asking one question?
What do you mean by thorough investigation?
Objective investigators, not someone asking the perpetrator whether he carried out the act, but someone, you know, a proper legal process, or a legalistic process, should I say.
Yes.
Because I don't believe that's appropriate with Sai Baba.
Why not?
Because my heart and my conscience tell me that is not possible.
Is Sai Baba above the law then? I mean...
No, he's not above the law. I don't believe that it's possible that he could do anything like that.
In November 1999, Dr. Goldstein was chief guest of honor at a ceremony for Sai Baba's university. But he still managed to raise a liar's story with Sai Baba personally. It seemed to spark a remarkable reaction.
And then I found out from my friend James, who had actually videotaped, that the day after Michael, or the same day that Michael had talked to Baba about us, Baba came out with a discourse in which he praised Michael Goldstein more than he's ever praised any devotee in history.
Dr. Goldstein, today, Dr. Goldstein, the chief guest,
he's not an ordinary person.
ఏ ధనం నందు కూడా తక్కువ లేదు.
He's rich enough.
ఏ విద్య ఎందు తక్కువ లేదు.
He's highly educated.
ఏ పేరు ప్రతిష్ట ఎందు తక్కువ లేదు.
And he's great man.
గొప్ప పేరు ప్రతిష్ట కలిగినటువంటి వాడు.
He's highly reputed.
ఈ మూడు కూడా ఉంటున్నాయి. Discipline, devotion, duty.
He has got all the three sacred qualities. Discipline, duty and devotion.
వారి భార్య కూడా అక్కడే కూర్చుంది.
His wife is also seated there.
And Michael came up to James and said, I want a copy of that video. It's the peak of my life. And I remember thinking, he's being played. I just remember feeling like Bob is playing him.
Goldstein has all good qualities in him.
Do good.
So do good.
Be good.
Be good.
And see good.
And see good.
This is the way to God.
This is the way to God.
All of these years, I've seen him interact with the students very, very frequently in very informal circumstances over many, many years. And because I am a physician, I also understand human behavior. Because of that, if Sai Baba had done anything of this kind with any one of those boys at any time ever, I would see something in one of those children's eyes. I would see something in one of the expressions on their faces that would indicate to me fear, apprehension, depression, something unsavory, something inappropriate, something scary, something ominous. I would know it in my heart because I am what I am, a consummate professional. Can you understand that?
The Ram certainly didn't understand. In despair, they contacted Isaac Tigrett of the Hard Rock Cafe. He was sympathetic, but not very helpful.
His dad talked to me, and I said, look, I'm sorry if this happened to your family, to your son, whatever. Anyone would be sympathetic, anybody. I said, but it's not changing my feelings about Sai Baba. It just isn't.
So even if it was proven to you that Sai Baba was a pedophile and a serial sex abuser, you're saying it wouldn't change the fact that he is your guru?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. He could go out and murder someone tomorrow, as I said. It's not going to change my evolution. It's not going to change the good things that come out of my relationship down there.
Does that mean that some part of you believes there could be some truth to the rumors?
Oh, absolutely. I believe there is truth to the rumors.
You believe there is truth to the rumors?
Sure, there probably is. Probably is.
Back at the ashram, and this god was back on his feet, looking better, but still a little shaky. Just like the scandals that increasingly dog him, it seems that nothing in the end is able to bring down Sai Baba. There's always an explanation for everything.
నుంచి 3 టన్నుల బరువు పోయింది. Out of the stomach emanated shivalingas of the weight of 3 tons. కనుకనే దేహములకు ఒక విధమైన అలసట కలిగింది. That's the reason why some strain on the face of the body.
Sai Baba went on to explain his love and compassion for his students.
All boys are golden.
అందువల్ల వారి నేను ఎప్పుడైనా సరే నేను వారిని ప్రాణదంశం చేస్తాను.
Therefore, Bhagavan will protect them at any time, anywhere.
నేను ఏమాత్రము యోచించకుండా.
Don't worry.
Past is past. Forget the past.
Past is past. Forget the past.
For those who've suffered at Sai Baba's hands, forgetting the past is not so easy. In Arkansas, Elia Ram is trying to make it as a music producer, but he's still haunted by what happened. Mark Roach is also trying to overcome his experiences. He flew to Arkansas to share them with the Ram family. Despite their anger at what happened to them, these former devotees know they must move on with their lives.
The odd, perverse, ironic, hypocritical thing of it is that he's the one that's doing the perverse things, but making us feel the guilt about it.
Yeah.
You know, given normal worldly standards, it's the kind of thing that he deserves to have his face pummeled to the ground for.
Yeah.
You know, and you see him above that, which is to your credit. And I don't know how the heck you had the courage to get through it all. It seems like you have.
I like to say that I'm over it, but I don't think that I'll ever be over it. A lot of decisions that I make are still, you know, weighted by experiences that I've been through, and a lot of them had to do with Sai Baba, you know what I mean? He's behind the door, you know, with his wrath, you know what I mean? There's time. Yeah.
At the ashram, God was retiring for the evening. As he went, I wondered what it would take to dent the faith. The allegations seemed to have no effect, and perhaps it is asking too much for someone to abandon their God. For the followers of Sai Baba, it's just another test of their faith.
Have your say on tonight's show and explore a world of extra information, news stories and features by visiting our website at bbc.co.uk/thisworld.